Good morning. I'm Bruce Kennison, and welcome to the Easter Sunday service of the London United Methodist Church. It's been 1 year since we were last together at this time. It's hard to imagine how the time has passed with all the restrictions and difficulties by the pandemic, but I'm glad you're here with us today. I hope you'll be able to enjoy some of the beauties of the simple life of being home, of not traveling, and maybe find a way to pass the time in an enjoyable fashion. So please, to start off, join me now with our mission statement, loving God, loving people, making a difference. Now let's begin with the service.
Welcome to this Easter day and our celebration here at Londonderry United Methodist. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Join me with a word of prayer as you see the words on your screen. Holy One, Justice Seeker, Lover of Creation, you are the restorer of life, the conqueror of all that is death-dealing in our hearts, in our lives, in this world. Come and dance with us, dazzle us with your brilliance, move us to be awake to your salvation so that we can rise with you. Be with us now, for we pray. Amen. It is time for the young at heart to come forward for a message. Come on up or snuggle in, whatever you do on Sunday or Monday, whenever you watch the church video. Hi, welcome. I'm so glad to see you this Easter day. Oh my goodness. Are you full of Easter candy? What's your favorite part of Easter? The eggs? Oh! The Easter basket? Oh! Visiting with grandma and grandpa? Oh, some people can't do that yet, can they? No. Did you have fun decorating the eggs? Yeah. Well, oh, why am I holding the umbrella? Because for many, many centuries, a century is 100 years, Easter parades were full of umbrellas. Yeah, sometimes they're called parasols, and it was not because it was raining out, but it was for protection from sun, but also it's about bright colors, reminding us of Easter and the beauty of the day that Easter is. Christ is risen. It brings joy to our hearts, and bright colors often bring joy to people's hearts. So that's why Easter parades often have umbrellas and parasols. So we're going to actually have an umbrella with us every week for the next 8 weeks. And what we're going to be doing is writing on these umbrellas eventually. But today, I'd like you to find an umbrella at home, and I want you to decorate it. Dangle something from each of these pieces that brings you joy. It could be a cross, a picture. It could be a toy frog. It could be a toy of any sort. Decorate your umbrella and twirl it around and make a parade of it. It'll be really fun. And the joy that you have, the fun, is meant to remind you of the internal joy that Christ has brought to your heart, the joy that he brings because he is a savior. So I'd like right now to ask you to repeat after me, and we're going to have a prayer. We offer thanks for Jesus Christ and his grace showering us newly every day. We give thanks for dreamers, for all they are and all they do. Let us become dreamers too, and bring new life to me and you. Amen. Amen. Wonderful. Thanks for joining me, and I'll see you next week, and have your umbrella ready. God loves you. Christ has saved you. Bye-bye.
Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to get Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they've laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but did not go in. And then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrapping lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in and saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. And the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" And she said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'" And Mary went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told him that he had said these things to her. This is the liberating Easter word of God for all the people of God. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Amen.
Isaiah 25, verses 6 through 9. On this mountain the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said that on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. These are the words of God for the people of God. Amen.
Ah, Mary. The story begins with Mary doing what many of us do beside the cemetery, praying beside somebody's grave. Mary was at the tomb that she didn't know was empty. The tomb was her quiet place of prayer, where she wept for having broken her promises, her parental promises to her son Jesus. Those promises that are made quietly, internally, at the start of a life of becoming a parent. Vows no one hears aloud until much later in life. Vows such as, I vow to protect you. I will never let anybody hurt you. Nothing will hurt you on my watch. Like any parent, Mary made implicit promises at Jesus's birth, which only grew more explicit as their relationship developed and as his mission unfolded. Implicit promises initiated she and Joseph fleeing Herod. Implicit promises were made visible when she stopped the entire extended family caravan to find Jesus at age 12 when he stayed behind in the temple. Remember that scene? When Jesus stayed behind, kind of like Home Alone 2. I imagine Mary was much like Kevin's mom, you know, in that movie. She's like a ninja, not sleeping for 48 hours and going so far as to ride with animals in the back of a caravan to get home to her loved one. finding Jesus in the temple. It was the fulfillment of a vow, a promise. I promise never to leave you. We all make vows to people, implicitly or explicitly, whether we're aware of it or not. Parents to children, children to parents, neighbors to neighbors, partners to partners, in-laws to in-laws, pastors to worshipers, a president to a nation, Congress to a nation, representatives and senators to a state, players to a team, teachers to their students, dog groomers to their customers, employers to their employees, doctors to their patients. In Ireland, there is an ancient abbey called Cung Abbey. The Augustinian Abbey was founded in the early 12th century by High King of Ireland, Turlough O'Connor. I'm going to show you a picture or pictures here. It was built on the site of a 6th century church associated with St. Faithin. Let me have you look closely at these pictures. It's a popular destination for travelers. Cung Abbey features examples of fine stone carving throughout the extensive property. The abbey is considered to be one of the finest examples of early architecture in Ireland. The abbey served many purposes, including a hospital for the sick, shelter for the poor and starving, as well as being a place of learning for thousands of scholars. On the abbey grounds is a delightful 15th to 16th century Augustinian monk fishing house built over the River Cung. See it here in the picture. In the floor of the house is a trap door so the monks could fish in relative comfort, sitting in chairs and waiting for the fish to come. Fishing lines dangled from the hole in the floor, attached to a bell when they had other duties to do. And when a catch came along, the bell would ring, and if the cook was in, could hear it and go fetch it, or just wait and let it dangle there till dinner was ready to be served. The monks could sit on either side of the hole in the floor, holding a line while carrying on their deep theological conversations or just to relax. The interesting thing about this floor is the water running under it. It flowed continuously. The water flowed downstream, away. Everything carried away. Their thoughts floated away. Their prayers floated away. Poet Michael White wrote a poem while sitting there in 2015. It's a poem about promises and vows. Hear his poem. Make a place of prayer, no fuss. Just lean into the white brilliance and say what you needed to say all along. Nothing too much. Words as simple as yours and as heard as the bird song above your head or the river running gently beside you. Let your words join to the world, the way stone nestles on stone, the way water simply leaves and goes to the sea, the way your promise breathes and belongs with every other promise the world has ever made. Now leave them, go on. Let your words alone to carry their own life without you. Let the promise go to the river. Have faith, walk on. The original vow Mary made once to Jesus was necessary. Time and circumstance changed the vow. It was time for Mary to let the river carry her vow away, let her prayers join others and on out to the sea. Scripture tells us, however, that Mary wouldn't let the vow go. She was held hostage to protecting Jesus, though he was dead and risen. So held hostage was she that she didn't even recognize Jesus in front of her. And so while she's holding on tight to that old vow, Jesus was living a new life, a new vow. Mary still wouldn't break the vow, the former vow. It is taboo to break vows in our culture. Like the Ford Motor Company ad says, they didn't become who they are by not changing over their 100-year history. Some vows have to be broken in order for new life to develop and take flight. Mary held herself hostage to that 33-year-old vow to Jesus. And it was not until Jesus summoned her loudly, "Mary," not until he beckoned her out of her imprisonment that she understood. It was then that Mary allowed Jesus to liberate her from that parental vow. That vow, in Michael White's words, that needed to go down the River Kong. Mary rose with new life, new joy, and joined Jesus in that resurrection dance. Sometimes, truthfully, we are like Mary. Our vows, important as they are in one circumstance, change. But we don't change with the circumstances. We allow ourselves to become depleted, depressed, imprisoned by those vows. When something wakes us up to realize we need a change, like hearing the words from Jesus, "Mary." For example, consider this past year, the vows of healthcare workers. In hard-hit states, the vow to do no harm with limited resources was excruciating. It put healthcare workers with Mary and Michael White in a place of prayer. Healthcare workers were directed to give the limited ventilators to people most likely to survive. Cradled in this moment of time, this pandemic, the vow, do no harm, with the River Kong flows away, and new vows rise as Jesus rises. We learn that we have to do things differently in the medical world. Or consider for a moment the changing vows of the school teacher to be prepared with lesson plans for remote learning, hybrid learning, and then back to in-person, and only to go back to remote learning and then hybrid learning all over again. Cradled in this moment, in this pandemic, the vow to teach with technological learning curves and flops, with the epic anxiety of the teachers and the students alike, the vows flow downstream, meeting the ocean, and the promise is broken. New vows rise up as Jesus rises, and it will be okay. Or consider the pastors with vows to visit house to house. Cradled in this moment of time, this pandemic, the vows imbalanced. Hospital call after hospital call to pull the plug, to pray final prayers beside the bed and the burial plots, while also learning how to manage worship videos. Let the vows go down the river with the river of the River Kong. Make a place of prayer. Let those old vows go. Have faith. New vows will appear like Jesus risen to give us new life and new hope. Or consider the parents with vows to protect children. The epidemic of anxiety crushing the mental health system across the nation and our already beleaguered system in New Hampshire is out straight. Parents, in this moment of time, this pandemic, the vow to protect takes on new and different meaning. Let the old vows go. Let them wash away like Mary's tears go down the River Kong. Make a new vow. Teach yourself and your child yoga, meditation, anti-anxiety methods. Have faith. walk away from the former vow, make a new vow. Mary did. Mary, Jesus' parent, walked away and made a new vow, a vow not to be imprisoned by the current circumstances, a new vow, a more fitting vow, to be actively engaged in learning how to regulate an anxious child. Have faith, parents, have faith, walk away, walk on to a new vow. You young people, college age, high school, middle school, elementary school, your lives, like we adults, are forever changed by anxiety and the pandemic. It does not have to change you with the imprisonment of anxiety and depression. You can make a place of prayer. Walk on, make a place of prayer, have it be a place of commitment to yourself, ask for help. Do not be alone. Learn new skills for regulating your anxiety. Have faith. Walk away. Walk on to a new way of living. Walk away from imprisonment. Mary did her best with the vow she made 33 years before Jesus rose. And then it was time for the vow to die so Jesus could live. Our lives will never be the same because of the pandemic, and just like Mary's life was never the same, we have new hope. It will get better. Joy will return. Make a new vow today. Make a vow to live in the freedom of the risen Christ. Live holy, live free. Don't live in bondage to this pandemic. Let the old vows go with the River Kong. Let it wash away. Make new vows for life and living. Jesus Christ is waiting. His new life is waiting for you. Take a hold. Amen.
And now for our offertory. Our dance with God needs fuel and energy. If we are to dance the dance of justice, find the steps of service, invite others to dance with us, we must have the resources that will assure that we have the tunes and the teachers to continue this holy dance. Won't you give now so the dance of God can be full and free in this place? I should note that because we've not been together in 1 year, the usual offerings we receive are down. To make it easier for you to give, we have online giving, and of course, you can always stop by the church or mail in your donations. Now, let us pray. Thank you for showering salvation upon our lives, Jesus Christ. Bless and multiply the resources and energy of our lives. We seek to serve you in the mission here, regionally, and abroad. In the name of Christ, amen.
Let us join our hearts together now in prayer. Let us pray. On this Easter morn, we welcome you, Jesus, into our lives. We welcome your resurrection, for it is life-changing, life-giving, and life-sustaining. We welcome the hope it brings to our world. We welcome the joy it brings to our darkness. We welcome the empty tomb, for we know that it means you are on the loose among us. Lord, may your resurrection give life to those who feel lifeless, those who are just going through the motions and holding on for dear life, and those who have faced the death of a loved one. We pray now for those in our midst who are acknowledging this Easter day for the first time without their loved one. Hear us in this silence. Lord, may your resurrection give hope to those who are mixed and mired in despair, who feel hopeless, and who have given up all hope. Lord, may your resurrection give joy to those who feel no joy, lost their joy, or who have had their joy snuffed out by this pandemic. Lord, you are loose in the world as the risen one. Help us to be your witness in this world. Help us to be your joy. Help us to share good news with those whom we meet. Hear us now, O Lord, as we commit our lives and our communications to those who we know to be in need. Hear us in this silence. We give thanks, dear Lord, for all the healthcare workers working tirelessly. Thank you for school teachers and professors. Thank you for the parents and the caregivers who continue day after day. Lord, hear our praise. Give them continued endurance and strength. Help them continue to rise with courage. For we ask this in your name and for your sake, as we pray together the prayer you taught your disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you.
Well, that's it. Our service is over. I'm glad you could be with us today. I wish we could have been in the church together to shake your hand, pat you on the back, maybe give you a word of encouragement, and otherwise just enjoy some fellowship together. But that's just a little bit longer off. It's not that far away. So let's be safe. Let's enjoy ourselves virtually in the company of God and know that the fellowship goes beyond just being in one room, but being in the body of Christ. I want to thank you for being with us on this day. I invite you to come back next week, because Easter is not just a day, it's a season, a week of weeks, meaning that we will be daring to dance for the next 7 weeks until the day of Pentecost. As a benediction, I want to share these words that we'll hear more of next week as we're inspired by the song lyrics from the singer Lee Ann Womack. Promise me that you'll give faith a fighting chance. And when you get the choice to sit down or dance, I hope you'll dance. And may the loving God, risen Christ, and dancing Spirit fill you with all the needs for the days ahead. And all God's people said, Amen. Have a good day and happy Easter.